morning. So glad to be with you guys today. I never get to come to Intermediate Chapel. It's such a fun thing. All right, so even though I haven't been here, I have been watching some of the messages online, and so I believe Mrs. Hoyt spoke to you guys last week. Can someone tell me, what did we learn about last week? Does anyone remember all the way last Thursday with Faithful? Yes, Casey. Right, so they entered Vanity Fair, and then what happened when they got there? Yes, I think. Right, so they were teased and taunted, and they suffered. And then what happened with Faithful? Yes. Right, he was martyred, right, for his faith. And you talked about Stephen in the Bible being the first martyr. And then after that happens, Christian's leaving Vanity Fair, right? Because he was let go. And who does he meet? Let's see, Reese? Well, yes, he meets Brian. So before that, before he leaves Vanity Fair, Alex? Hopeful, right? And we talked about Hopeful just bringing him hope, right? After he lost his friend Faithful. And one of the things that Hopeful says, he says, there are some more boys and girls, too, who say that they will not stay in this city much longer if such cruel things are done there. So what does that tell you about what happened to Faithful? What was the purpose behind that? Right, and so Faithful was martyred for his faith. Was there a greater purpose behind that? We just heard from Hopeful that there's other people now that are thinking something's not right. Yes, Bella?
The purpose was to get other people to
be. Right, so now we have Hopeful who saw what happened and he was inspired by Christian and by Faithful and it's Faithful's faithfulness, right? They were inspired and now more people are starting to think something's not quite right in Vanity Fair. Maybe I don't want to stay here, right? So that's kind of what you talked about last week, about how sometimes people are martyred for their faith or have to go through difficult trials for their faith, but God always has a purpose. So that's kind of where we picked it up this week with buy-ins. And so Hopeful and Christian, they're leaving the city and they're making their way on the path. And they come across another person who looks like a pilgrim, right? And his name is buy-ins, which is kind of an odd name. When I was looking at it, I was like, I don't really know what this name means. Does anyone know? Anyone have a guess? Educated guess? Yes. He gets the easy way out of everything. Yes. What else? What else do we know about buy-ins? So it says he was very rich. He was very proud of his high position. And he was inclined to despise Christian and Hopeful. So what do you think? What do we know about his character? Yes. Himself. Yes, he's maybe a little bit full of himself. He kind of thinks that he's the best, the richest. Yes? So maybe he's not really a pilgrim. He says he's a pilgrim, but does his characteristics match up with that of a pilgrim? Not really, right? He's rich, he's proud. Yes, did you have something else to add? He's very talkative, yes. He's very talkative. He wants to boast about all of the wonderful things of his city, about how rich he is, and about how high his position is in the city. And I looked it up, and buy-ins means somebody or something that has a selfish motive, right? He wants to follow the king as long as things are going well, and he selfishly wants to get something out of it. So they meet buy-ins, and he basically says, can I come along with you guys? I'm a pilgrim too. I love to walk on the path as long as it's sunny. Can I walk with you? And he is from a city near Vanity Fair. Now in your book, I don't think it says what the name of that city is, but in the original Pilgrim's Progress, it said it is called the land of fair speech. What do you think fair speech means? Can you guess it? Fair speech. Yes, it's right here. So maybe everyone gets to say it. That would make sense, right? Fair speech. But do we think that really matches up with what Brian is like? No. So what do we think? Their speech. Yes. Okay, maybe he thinks he could talk all the time. So a fair speech is speech that sounds really nice, right? It sounds very fair and pleasant, but it doesn't always back it up with actions, right? It just sounds nice on the surface. So everything that Brian says sounds really nice. He says, I'm a pilgrim, I want to follow the king. But what he's done in his life and how he lives his life doesn't quite match up. And that's how most of the people from Fair Speech are. And it's easy to follow Christ or the king in this sense when things are going well, right? When you're getting good grades, when maybe your sports team's playing really well, everything's going well for you. It's really easy to follow Christ, right? But it gets harder when you have things coming at you that aren't so easy, right? And we'll see what happens with Brian's. So, all the people from Fair Speech, they have selfish motives. And the book describes them as people who call themselves the king's servants and pretend to love him very much. But whenever the wicked prince or his servants came to see them, they left off talking about the king and behaved as if the wicked prince was their ruler. Have you ever met somebody like that? You don't have to shout out their name, but raise your hand if you've ever met somebody who says that they are maybe a Christian or follow Christ, but their actions don't match up. Yeah. Have you ever felt like maybe you might do that sometimes? You don't have to raise your hand. Yeah. But think to yourself, do my actions always match up with what I say? It's hard sometimes, right? And also, the book mentions that the wicked prince liked these people. He didn't worry about them going on the pilgrimage, right? He was like, they're not going to have to be any worry of mine because they're not going to really follow the king when it comes down to it. So he didn't even bother throwing in any sort of like storms or hindrances to stop them because he knew they were easily distracted. As opposed to Christian and faithful, they had a lot of trials, haven't they? Christians had a lot to go through. Why do you think that people like Christian, who are real pilgrims, sometimes have more trials to face? Because they definitely do. If you're sincere and you're following Christ, you may come against more trials. Why would that happen? Ashley? Maybe to test your faith, right? What else? Yes? Right, yeah. Wouldn't that be nice if God said, I'm going to make everything easy for you, right? But that's not how it happens. God wants to make sure that you are going to be faithful to him regardless of what happens. And sometimes the enemy wants to send things that are harder to those that he knows are true Christ followers. Okay? And that's to make sure that you can stand firm, right? He's trying to get Christian and people like Christian off of the path. But if they're true pilgrims, they're not going to be swayed. Brian and his friends are a little bit swayed easily, right? In James 1, 2 through 4, it says, consider it pure joy whenever you face trials of many kinds. Do you guys ever think about when you're going through something bad that you should be joyful? You know, if you're going through struggling in school, or maybe you've lost all of your basketball games, you think you should be joyful? It's hard, right? That's what God calls us to do. So we will continue on, and Brian really, really wants to join Hopeful and Christian on their journey, right? He says he's a pilgrim. He wants to have some people to walk with. Does Christian allow him to come with them? No. Right? Have you ever heard the term fair weather friends? It's a phase, which means that your friends are only around when it's something good is going on. Fair weather friends. They're not around for you when you are going through something bad. Brian is kind of a fair weather Christian, right? He only wants to walk when there's clear summer weather. Hopeful says it's a beautiful day. Brian's just like, yeah, let's go walking. But let's not bother walking if it gets windy or stormy. Okay, same kind of thing. He doesn't have that roots that you need when you're going to go through trials. So Brian decides to stay by himself because Christian says he doesn't really think that they would be, you know, on the same page all the time. Christian also says, it is unwise for pilgrims to have friends who are not the king's true servants. Why do you think that it is unwise? This is difficult for some people. Yes.
They might, like, start
doing
what I do.
Right, so they may be influenced, right, in not a good way. Yes, Emily, did you have something?
Like,
Bayern a lot, he might tempt them to just take a little rest if the weather gets bad, or maybe turn around instead of making their way all the way to the celestial city. It's really hard to have friends who don't believe the exact same thing as you, because you want to still be able to talk with them about Christ, but it's difficult to become close friends with them when you don't have the same sort of ideas. And also, not every unbeliever we meet is going to be immediately evil, right? We learned that last week with the nice lady in Vanity Fair. She was very nice and kind to Christian, but she also was not a pilgrim or follower of the king. So it's really important to be careful about who we're spending most of our time with. So eventually, after Christian and Hope will continue on without him, what happens with Vianen? So they move on without him. He's walking by himself. What happens? Paige? Yeah. And are these people that join him, are they pilgrims? Yes or no? No, right? They're people from the same place he's from. And they tell him, the king's servants are always like that, like he's talking about Christians. If you don't exactly agree to everything they say, they won't have anything to do with you. I have heard that many times. Have you ever heard that someone say that about Christians? If you don't do exactly what they say, they don't want to hang around you. Unfortunately, some people believe that. Okay, but it's our job as Christians to make sure that we're speaking the truth in kindness, and that while we don't want to be close friends with people like Brian, we still want to be able to speak truth into their life. So his friends come up, not good influences, and they're telling them, don't worry about Christian and Hopeful. They can go on. We're going to just have fun and take the easy route. And so then they catch up with Christian and Hopeful. And what do they ask Christian? You guys remember? So they catch up, and all of his friends are teasing and taunting Christian. And they're asking him all kinds of questions to try to trip him up. They're asking, what about this? Is this right? What about this? Is that right? Do you guys remember a Bible story that's kind of like that? Maybe that happened to Jesus? I'm not sure if you guys have talked about this in school yet. Bella? Yeah, the Pharisees did this all the time to Jesus. They were coming up to him all the time, asking him questions, trying to trick him and get him in a trap, right? Trying to get him to say something that wasn't right. Same thing, this is kind of happening to Christian, right? All of these people from Bayan's town are coming up, taunting him, teasing him, trying to get him to kind of not say what's right. But does he mess up? Does he say something wrong? No, he's bold. He is bold in the truth. And I think that's what Mrs. Edwards was talking about. He's grown a lot, right? He's not afraid to stand up anymore. After he saw what Faithful went through and how Faithful stood strong to the end, he's going to make sure he's speaking the truth the whole time. And so that's kind of the same thing that happened to Jesus. After his friends kind of taunt him, Hopeful and Christian keep going, and they reach a little path leading to a mine off to the side. And a man is standing there. I believe his name is Demas. I'm not sure if I'm saying that right. And he is asking Christian and Hopeful, come on over to the mine. I've got all kinds of riches for you. It's a nice, easy path. I'm a pilgrim too. And what do Christian and Hopeful do? The safe mine, yes. Was it really safe? No, it wasn't safe. And Christian knew that. He recognized that this man was not a pilgrim either. And he was trying to distract them. What do you think the silver mine represents in our world? It could represent a lot of things. What does it represent for you? Yes, temptation of any kind. Temptation. What are some temptations we might have that could represent that? McKinley? Treasure, silver, material things. Maybe it's a brand new PlayStation. Maybe it's, you can get one. Maybe it's, I don't know, that thing that you wanted for your birthday forever, right? It's a temptation. Or maybe it's something you want to do with your friends, that you're hanging out with them, and it's maybe not something you really should do, but it looks fine. Doesn't really look bad. Those are all temptations that you could have. And Christian and Hopeful recognize that this is just a temptation. Bayans and his friends come along, and they do not recognize that. What do they do? Yeah. They just go to the mine, and they're never heard from or seen them again. Babe, in the Bible, Demas is actually a person. I didn't know this when I was researching for this. He's mentioned in the Bible very briefly as a friend of Paul's. I know some of you have learned about Paul. He's mentioned as a friend of Paul's who was at first a Christ follower and then became enchanted with everything that the world had to offer, and he left Paul and stopped following Christ. So this is another example of a kind of an actual person from the Bible being put into the story. But Christian again spoke boldly and said, no, we're not going to the mine. That will stray us from our path. If there are a lot of things that can stray you from your path, right? They don't always look bad. The silver mine doesn't look bad on the surface. There's just some treasures in it. There's a nice man saying, come on in. Okay? Nothing that looks immediately bad. But there are so many things out there that can take you off of the path that God has set for you. And it is so important that you are staying strong and staying bold in your faith so that you can recognize those things and that you can, you know, say no to temptation and stay strong on that path. So we have a couple of lessons from this. The first one, God calls us to follow him even when things are difficult. Okay? Bayans and his friends, they didn't really want to follow the king if things got difficult. They only wanted to follow if it was sunny, was nice weather, if they were something in it for them. Okay. But Christian and Hopeful, they wanted to follow regardless. They didn't care if there was winds. They didn't care if there were storms. They didn't care if somebody was offering them riches over here. They knew that their one goal was to get to the celestial city and to serve the king. That's what we need to work on in our lives, right? It's so hard to stay focused when there's all these extra things going on around us. Especially things that don't really look bad on the surface. That's when you really have to remember God's word and remember what he has set before you, the path he set before you. Second lesson, be bold in speaking the truth. Christian has definitely learned this as he's went on, right? He wasn't originally as bold, but through all the trials he's went through, from losing his friend, he has learned to be bold and say what the truth is from the beginning. Psalm 138:3 says, when I called, you answered me. You made me bold with strength in my soul. If you don't feel bold, it's okay. God will give you that boldness and that strength if you ask him. Sometimes it's really hard to be bold, but God is always there to help you. And the third thing is, treasure God in your relationship with him rather than material items. That silver mine represents all the material items that maybe would make you stray from God. And those items on their own aren't bad, but if you're spending more time on them than you are on your walk with Christ, that's where it becomes a hindrance to your walk. Okay, and Matthew 6:19 says, "For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." Okay, if you want your heart to be with Christ and following him, you have to make sure that it's not too much with the material things of this world. Our key coordinates, I picked this verse because it's also my life verse, but I also think it applies. So Proverbs 3:5-6 says, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways submit to him and he will direct your paths." It could have been really easy for Christian and Hopeful to start trusting in other things. There were a lot of distractions on this path, but they chose to trust in God and the path that he had laid out for them. And they chose to be bold and confident that he knew what he was doing, and that if they spoke boldly the truth, that they would be able to resist the temptation. So I just want to challenge you today, as you're going about your day, to make sure that you are boldly speaking the truth in everything you do, and that you're following God's path for you and not getting too distracted by everything else. And if you feel like that's difficult for you, just ask God. He's going to give you that boldness and courage. He's always going to be there for you, and he's going to help you stay on that path. Would you pray with me today? God, thank you so much for today. Thank you for this time together that we had to speak and just learn about your word and to learn about this story and what it teaches us for our lives, God. I pray that you will be with each student today as they go about the rest of their day. and that they will remember what they've learned today and all these weeks so far in chapel, and that they will remember that you are always with them, guiding their paths, and that they can be not afraid to be bold in speaking your truth. In your name I pray. Amen.